Hallucinations are perceptions without stimulus. So you're seeing something when nothing is there. You're hearing something when nothing is making a noise. You're feeling something when nothing is touching you. You're tasting or you're smelling something when nothing is there. That's a hallucination. And a delusion is a false belief that, you know, and I always say that you believe that your neighbors are aliens, for example, is a delusion. And as I've also said in previous talks, that we used to be able to say that MI5 is listening to you is a delusion, but not anymore.
You've been listening to quite a complicated talk, and I'd like for you to ask some questions, ask them some questions, I should say. Please, don't hesitate. If you haven't understood something, just raise your hand and repeat it again. If you're not clear about something, please repeat it again. After the shout, salam alaikum.
Okay. Your turn. Could you elaborate on the hadith about Umar, about the drunk person? I haven't heard of this before.
Okay. So, to my recollection, and those who know better can correct me if I'm wrong, the story was that there was a man, I don't know if he was of the Sahaba, if he had met the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but certainly a man in the community at that time who was known to become inebriated with alcohol. And Umar radiallahu anhu was in a gathering. And Umar radiallahu anhu, you know, we know is regarded as being very fierce and very strong. And our incorrect understanding of Umar radiallahu anhu may lead us to believe that he would simply ask for the man to be punished immediately and that would be that. And certainly it's a punishable offense. But what he did was in that gathering, he wrote a letter to the man and he asked the messenger to give it. And in the letter, he reminded the man of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy that you can always send back to Allah, but also that his punishment was severe. So showing him that there's a way out of his situation, but that he had responsibility to act to change his behavior. He also secondly asked the messenger only to give the message to him when he had come to his senses, because in the time when he was not within his senses, he could do anything, tear the letter up, spit on it, lose it, forget about it, and certainly wouldn't be amenable to listening. So we have to have that wisdom as well, that if somebody's temporarily not in their senses, we need to wait until they come to their senses before we give them the message. He also importantly, in a compassionate way, asked the people who were in the gathering that he was with to make dua for this person. And that's something that we should also do. We shouldn't simply be pointing at fingers at people, even where they are clearly doing wrong, but they are in distress. But we should ask Allah to guide them and ask Allah for good to come to them. And so that was the nature of the story that I remember.
Sister, in the front.
Walaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Jazakallah khairan. As I've said before in previous talks, I'm not a faqih, I'm not here to be able to give you a fatwa. But what I would say as a psychiatrist is that as Muslims, we're supposed to be looking at the world always through the prism of the Quran and the Sunnah. And so if it so happens that you go to a GP or refer to a psychologist or onto a psychiatrist and are given psychotherapy, there are different forms of psychotherapy, and many forms of psychotherapy are simply trying to help us to reflect on common sense. So cognitive behavioral therapy, which is used for anxiety and depression commonly, is there to help you think about your cognitions, your thinking, and your behavior. It might ask you to have structure to your day, because that is seen as important, and your five-time salah is structure. So if they say, when they say introduce structure into your life, and they tell you to make a date with a friend to go to a coffee shop every week and do several other things. Some of those things might be halal and you could do them, and some would not be. And they probably are not going to go and tell you to make sure you pray your five daily prayers on time. But we can think to ourselves, they're asking to have structure into our life. I've been so depressed, I haven't been praying on time all the time. I'm going to make an extra special effort to pray on time. If they tell you to do something that's clearly wrong, I've heard of a social worker saying to a Muslim sister who is being abused by her husband, and obviously that is totally wrong and that's oppression and dhulm in Islam, and telling this Muslim sister, Maybe it's your culture that is oppressing you, and you should get rid of all this scarves and long clothes and buy some mini skirts and have some fun. And this was, you know, advice given by people here in this country. This is, you know, not new. So as a Muslim, you would say to yourself, well, giving up my haya is not a good thing. But I can understand that the person is saying that I should avoid oppression. And although they're thinking that my entire culture is oppression, I can disagree with that. But I can see where they're coming from and seeing people who are supposedly good people in my community oppressing me. And I should try and be clear to reject that and avoid that oppression and try and find somewhere to taste the sweetness of life. So what I would say is that if you give an advice on any topic, you should try and take that advice through the prism of the Quran and the Sunnah and accept that which is halal or neutral and reject that which is haram.
Yes, it's later. Like I beg your pardon.
Walaikum salam.
In your experience as a psychiatrist, do you believe that rapists can't stop raping children or women or both? And with drugs, these do not work. In Iran, they receive the death penalty, which is Sharia. Do you agree, yes or no?
I'm going to be careful how I answer that. And remember, I'm going to limit my answer to the knowledge and experience and expertise that I have.
Of course.
If it were the case that these people who are doing these evil acts are incapable of stopping, then surely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala they would be innocent. Because if they can't, if they are simply acting in a way without ability to change, then they're innocent. And we don't believe they're innocent. We believe, we can say to ourselves that X or Y person may be so evil that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described them as one of the people who they've even lost the sense of right and wrong. Their hearts have been blocked, their ears have been closed, their eyes have been veiled. But they got themselves to that point. They didn't start on that point. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't leave them in that point where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that they're not going to do anything for the rest of their lives to repent. Allah knows that. But they got themselves to the point where they have blackened their heart so severely that they're not going to change. So the fault of their situation is their own. And they're responsible for the situation they got. And in terms of specific punishments, again, I'm not going to be an expert, but we know that the hood punishments, where appropriate, are of course good in a society where that has been established. And they are there as not commonplace punishments, but to be a deterrent. In that society where the Prophet was, they did on occasion have to chop off the limbs of somebody who had been stealing, you know, volitionally, but that was rare and it was a deterrent. And on occasion, if somebody had committed murder, you know, in societies where there's no death penalty, there's no death penalty. But in this, in a Muslim-run society, if somebody does kill someone, they are liable to the death penalty where that is proven that they acted volitionally, that they were in keeping up with their senses, that there was no mistake, and that they've you know, in a clear-eyed way committed murder. And we know that that is also a deterrent. So I am not going to change or give any personal opinion on the punishments which Allah has decreed, other than to say that if we are Muslims, you know, we believe in them where they are applied in a correct way. But to say somebody cannot change is a dangerous statement, because it presupposes then that they're innocent of their actions, and they are not. And if they've reached a stage where they are now insatiably committing more and more wrong, they are the ones who got them into that themselves into that situation in the first place. And that's why, as I said, interestingly in this country, although somebody may get a finite sentence for something where they go to jail, but there's a double standard in the sense that if somebody does it and are seen to be insane, then the standard for releasing them is that they'll never do it again, reasonably.
Thank you, Doctor. Yes, David.
As a Muslim, I am not allowed to do what? Sorry?
Speak with loud.
You're allowed to believe in demonic possession and
Am I allowed to believe in demonic possession, did you ask? Yes. So we've discussed this in previous sessions, but what I have said before on this topic is that in the Quran, we know that Shaitan is going to say on the Day of Judgment that I had no power over you, but I called and you followed. And we know that the jinn made of flameless fire, we know that they exist, and this is something that every Muslim believes. And we know that they are beings created in a different way from humankind. And we know that that they can afflict us, which is different from saying control us. And we know that evil human beings can afflict us and influence us, and we may be tested to stay away from control. And we know that the very last ayah of the Quran, you know, where we're asking for protection from whom? Min al-jinnati wa nas, you know. So you're asking for protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in those last few ayahs in the Quran of all of these things, of the waswas, of the whisperings, of the evil that, you know, that goes into the hearts of men. And we're asking Allah for help. And so we know that where difficulty beset us, where humans or jinn are afflicting us, we seek refuge not in somebody who's going to recite something over you and write something and put it around your neck or promise you that they're going to speak to the jinn on your behalf. None of that. What we're going to do is going to ask Allah for help directly. And if we're in difficulty, we can ask our friends and our family to make dua for us. You can certainly ask the imam in the masjid to make dua for us. But where we start getting into, you know, almost manufactured beliefs of the nature of who is cursing us and who is controlling us, we're really straying from that which is clear, black and white, and deliberately going into the grey. And where people say, well, this happened, you know, within the Sahaba, and that happens to the Prophet, you know, we're going into the grey. We know that there's no power or might but from Allah. We know that whatever difficulty or even harm has come to us comes with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that He's the one that can bring us out of that. And if we keep it simple in that way, then we don't have to go into that which is a bit more grey. And the Quran, the Quran itself, it talks about how there are ayah in the Quran which are clear, and there are ayah in the Quran which are not clear. And that the one whose heart is diseased veers towards the things which are not clear. So let us be of those whose hearts veer to which that is clear, and ask of help from the one who is in control of all things.
Thank you.
Just a minute.
Paul.
Assalamu
alaikum.
Walaikum
salam. Very interesting talk. If I'm not mistaken, the psychiatric profession and psychologists as well today in the West tend to view homosexuality as a normal disposition. They no longer see it as a disorder or a psychiatric condition like they might have done in the past. How do you as a Muslim psychiatrist deal with that given Islamic teaching? Have you reached an understanding that
I see you asking me all the interesting questions on the day I'm being filmed. Okay. But I can answer that, inshallah, very clearly by talking about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, recounts that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did when people were trying to pressure him to accept some of their beliefs. Lakum dinukum waliya din. Okay. To you, your part, and to me, my own. And so, we can agree to disagree. We're living in a plural society. We're living in a society, and if we think of that society in Medina, that ummah in Medina, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was ruling, there were Muslims in that society in the early days. There were also some Jews, there were Christians, and there were mushriks. But they had to come to an agreement as to how they were going to live together. Now, we'll have people in this society who believe that it is utterly and totally unacceptable under any circumstances to eat any products with any animal ingredients whatsoever. They're not simply vegetarian, they're vegan. And they're doing that from a moral point of view, from their own moral point of view. We're not going to say to them that you are wrong and, you know, and push meat on them. They're doing what they're doing and we're doing what we're doing. We can say that there's no you know, they can do what they want to do, but we would not believe that it is utterly and totally wrong to use leather for a belt or to eat meat on occasion. Obviously, you'd want to eat food that is halal and tayyib, that is slaughtered in a halal way and that is raised in a wholesome way. We shouldn't want to support the way animals are mistreated, and we can agree on that. So we try to focus, and even when we're talking about the people of the book, let's focus on the things where we agree on, and where they're clear disagreements in one person's outlook versus our outlook, we can still deal with that person, we can still do business with that person, we can still treat them as a doctor. But where there are clear things where we have varying viewpoints, to your part and to me, my own.
Okay, Paul? Right. Any more questions? Yes.
Simple one. Okay. When do we, the society, think or accept that a person is insane in general? What sort of level would there have to be to think, for us to think that really there's something wrong? Is it insane? They're not capable of doing what they should be doing normally, and then we start thinking that there's something wrong with them. When is that stage? Can we limit it to something?
So what I was trying to say was that if we're judging somebody else, our judgment is often going to be imperfect. But this is all right in Islam, because you know, in Islam, even on the more important aspect of belief, of being a believer versus being a kafir, being somebody who actively rejects faith, we judge by what we see. You know, we cannot, you know, if somebody's acts are clearly showing faith, we can't accuse them of being a kafir. If somebody's acts are clearly taking them out of the circle of faith, we have to judge by what we see.
I mean, how far can they go for us to accept them as they are?
So again, with regard to somebody having lost their senses, we have to judge by what we see. It could be the case that somebody's unwell to some degree, but they are also to a degree putting on a bit of a show. It's possible. But we have to judge by what we see, and we may absolve that person incorrectly because we are judging by what we're seeing, and we're judging that they have a degree of being unwell that is worse than they truly are, that they are actually in control of their senses to a degree, but we can't see that. So that's all we can do. But the point I was trying to put across this afternoon is how we face it in our own lives, how we try and avoid being in a situation where it may be preventable for us landing up in difficulty. There'll be cases where you can't prevent it, and that's fine. And how we try and judge ourselves honestly so that we don't get the protection and the forgiveness of society, but we secretly know that we are doing wrong and that we know what we're doing. And so it's more important for us to be an honest judge for ourselves, because ultimately we're going to be judged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With regard to other people, we simply judge by what we see. And if we make mistakes, we make mistakes, but no judge, not even, unless the prophets would receive revelation when people would be lying to them. But we're not going to receive revelation if we are a judge. We're not going to get wahi telling us that the person is lying and telling them what's in their innermost hearts. So we judge by what we see.
Thank you. Okay, David.
In your experience, did you prescribe prayer for other treatment for abnormal insanity?
Would I prescribe treatment for insanity?
Prayer.
Sorry?
Praying.
Okay. So we would be encouraging somebody to pray always. Obviously, somebody who has temporarily lost their senses, the compulsory, the mandatory nature of their five daily salah is no longer there during the period where they've lost their senses. Mm. Just during that period. But other people around them can make dua for them to the extent they can understand what you are saying, even in a limited sense. You can ask them to ask their creator for help. In terms of the precise nature of the cause of their insanity, as we said, we pray for knowledge which is beneficial, and we would have a duty of Muslims to give them whatever treatment we could give them separately from that might be helpful. If it was an epileptic seizure, we might give them some medication for that. If they had a period of delirium where they didn't know what they were doing because they had an infection, you might give them antibiotics. And so people who have severe chest infections, for example, can be hearing things and seeing things and saying a lot of very strange things while they're unwell. If they had schizophrenia, you might give them antipsychotic medication. So you would treat it based on its merits of what the situation is at the time. But you certainly wouldn't say to somebody who's clearly lost any grip of their senses at the time that they need to immediately go to the masjid and pray. They're not even able to understand what you're saying and what to do. And so for them, for that brief period, the compulsory nature of the salah is not there, but you'd make dua for them and speak to them in a way which they could understand. To the best that they could.
Thank you. Laika.
Yeah. On that note, would you therefore disagree with rukia, like chaining people to chairs, etc., when they're not well?
Jazakallah khairan. So I think that the people have wildly different understandings of what the term rukya means. If we're talking about somebody reading the quls, the short surahs at the back of the Quran over the person, reading Ayatul Kursi, reading Surah Fatiha, that's always a good thing. And if that's what we're calling rukya, then that's always a good thing. If we're talking about chaining somebody to something for some strange reason, going to somebody strange and getting them to write things and put it over your neck and all of those things, then we would say that that's now, you know, leaving the path of what is clear. So to give a pronouncement on that word is wrong, because many people understand that word in different ways. And many of the understandings of the word are entirely a halal and tayyib things, positive things. But sometimes people use the word and say, well, you don't believe in using the Quran to treat somebody, and try and bully you into saying you accept that the word, which is fine, but then they go and do things which are clearly objectionable. So it's not the word, it's what you do.
Thank you, Dr. Zeyn. Alhamdulillah. Sister, one question. Yeah, come on, quick one. Loud, please.
Jazakallah khairan. Well, if we talk about Islamic point of view as being any positive knowledge, schizophrenia and multiple personality disorders are entirely different things. So in the movies, if you're watching, clearly you're watching the movies, schizophrenia is portrayed as multiple personalities. It is a strange falsehood that I've never understood. And I believed that schizophrenia was multiple personalities until I was in my fourth year at medical school, when I actually entered psychiatry and I realized they were totally different things. I have seen multiple personality disorder perhaps clearly once in my career. And I've seen schizophrenia many times. Multiple personality is where the person supposedly has got multiple personalities in them and suddenly one's popping up and then another. Schizophrenia is an illness which is relapsing and remitting. Relapsing as in you get worse and remitting and then you get better, which is characterized by delusions, which are false beliefs which are out of keeping with your social environment, and hallucinations. Hallucinations are perceptions without stimulus. So you're seeing something when nothing is there. You're hearing something when nothing is making a noise. You're feeling something when nothing is touching you. You're tasting or you're smelling something when nothing is there. That's a hallucination. And a delusion is a false belief that, you know, I always say that you believe that your neighbors are aliens, for example, is a delusion. And as I've also said in previous talks, that we used to be able to say that MI5 is listening to you is a delusion, but not anymore. So a delusion is a false and fixed thought that's out of keeping with your environment, and hallucination and perception. So that's schizophrenia. Multiple personalities is totally different. Jinn possession, as I've said a minute ago, the concepts of possession and control are controversial. There are people who insist that this happens and it's commonplace, and you know it's the brother-in-law's fault, etc., etc. But in the Quran, we know that Shaitan is going to on the Dajjal and say, I have no power over you, but I called and you followed. Is it the case that jinn and human beings can afflict us severely? Yes. And in the Quran, as I said in that last ayah, it tells us, you know, that we're asking protection. We're asking protection from all the friends of Shaitan, whether they're men, women, or jinn. Doesn't matter. But for us to believe that we are very easily made puppets and are controlled, again takes us into that phase where, as when we're discussing insanity, we're wanting to say we're just not responsible for anything. We're just not responsible. It's the djinn who's controlling. It's a very lazy thing to say, and it's a very easy way out to say, I'm a puppet on a string. And so we've got to take take back some control and some agency. We shouldn't be putting ourselves unnecessarily being the key, into situations where we are going to be susceptible to the whisperings of Shaitan. If we say, you know, I'm doing the wrong thing and I can't control what I'm doing, why are you in the nightclub, not you? Why is someone in the nightclub, you know, on weekends? Why are they, you know, watching objectionable movies? Why are they, you know, keeping objectionable company? And then they worry, then they're upset that they're doing bad things and they feel it difficult to resist that. Mm-hmm. You've got to, you know, be purifying your life. It's not simply about saying don't do this and don't do that and don't do this. Rather talk about what you should do. Fill your life with what is good. Fill your life with your 5 daily salah. Fill your life with being good to your parents. Fill your life with giving charity. Fill your life with good things. And you will push out the space and the time to be doing the evil stuff. And then you make yourself far less likely to be susceptible to all these whisperings that go into the hearts of us. And then we don't have to simply land up in a difficult situation and wildly starting fingers at people and things around us.
Thank you, Dr. Zeyn. Alhamdulillah. I must say the question and answer session was extremely interesting. We learned quite a lot. Yes, Mohammed, last question.
Assalamu alaikum, brother. Thank you very much for this interesting topic.
Waiyak, and to you.
I would like you to explain to us why there are a lot of Muslims in prison and psychiatric hospital in comparison to the older population.
Prison is something else.
So you want to know why there's so many Muslims in prison and psychiatric hospitals? Well, let me speak about the psychiatric hospital, because that's what I see. I don't work in prisons. I know that there's an imam who often goes to prison. Then perhaps you can ask him. You can ask him when he comes. Now, one of the reasons is interesting, that when we look at severe mental illness such as psychosis, the evidence shows that there are different things which increase the likelihood. One is use of drugs, cannabis, cut, etc. And so if Muslims are doing that, then they're going to be more likely to become unwell. But the second thing is what we talk about, the drift or breeder hypothesis. And this talks about second generation migrants. So we know that amongst second generation migrants, the incidence of psychosis is much higher. Now, second-generation migrants are not the people who move from Norway or Egypt or Pakistan or Chile to the UK. It's the children of those people. So if you have moved from another country, if you were born in another country, you're a first-generation migrant, but your children are second-generation migrants. So it's that second generation that for some reason have got a higher chance of becoming psychotic, and we're not sure why. One theory is breeder, as in the stress of being the child of a migrant in a foreign society where you've got one culture at home and one culture in the street is difficult for a person to reconcile, and so that it makes them more likely to for their minds to unravel and to become psychotic. And as we spoke about earlier, navigating life is about understanding Islam. So even with that struggle, if we understand that it is not our parents' culture which is 100% right, or our new culture which is 100% right, it is the culture of the guidance from our Lord which is 100% right. And where our parents' culture is in keeping with that, that's good. And where our host culture is in keeping with that, that's good. So we may come to the UK and in some senses we find that this is, in some cases I'm saying, that this is a fairer society. And the courts are slightly more fair than the country that our parents come from, maybe. But it may be that there are many other things from the culture that our parents come from which is much better. So if our benchmark is the guidance from Allah, then we don't have that confusion between which to follow. The second reason, possible reason, is that we know that you're far more likely to develop a severe mental illness if you live in a large city compared to a small city, compared to a small village. And many of the Muslims who've come here as migrants have come to London, to Manchester, to Birmingham, to the larger cities, rather than going to, you know, Aberystwyth in Wales. And so as a proportion of the population, our population is predominantly in larger cities. So that is one risk factor. Being second generation migrants is another risk factor. Drugs for people who use it is a third risk factor. But really, if we look at these things where it comes from confusion and not having deep roots, our roots in our culture need to be going back to the Quran and the Sunnah, not to a daughter wondering to whether she should wear a shalwar kameez or not. Yeah. No, we should understand that the point of dress is to dress with modesty, and we can dress within the culture that we live in as long as it's flowing and not form-fitting and following. So if we go back to the first principles of what Allah wants for us, then we have less of the confusion of the broken identity, of the not knowing what to follow, of the not knowing what our purpose is, and as our children tell us, of not knowing who they are.
Thank you, Professor. Nothing else, any questions? We don't get applause very often, but now and then you do get it. It's quite nice to have you, actually.
Thank you, Dr. Zeyn.
Very nice.